So there are three main questions that you should ask when you take any decision. Okay? First and foremost question, why a particular step? In this context, why mathematics? If you want to do a BSMS, why choose mathematics? If your course of action is, let's say, choosing biology, then why biology? This question is important from the point of view that you know your motivation well. Why are you pursuing a subject, a particular subject? There could be several reasons. Don't discard them. Don't deny your inclination. That's what I would suggest. Okay? Then comes after why. That why question is related to purpose, your motivation, and that also leads to self-discovery. Okay? What you want to do in next 5 years? Okay? Once you fix your answer, once you find out your answer, then you can ask how you are going to do it. After that, you can ask further question: what is to be done? What are the steps involved? So remember this order of questions: why, how, and what. Okay. Many times our tendency is that we get immediately involved in how and what without knowing why am I doing it, right? And then later on we find that, oh, I did not really like that part, but now since I have, you know, come all along, so I have to somehow drag myself to finish a task. Okay. So I hope now you are at the right stage to make a decision. So if you, you know, apply this read of questions, find out your own answers, it will be helpful for yourself to make a right choice. Okay? So let me tell you the how and what part when you choose mathematics as your major. So what are the broad areas that we have at the department? Okay, so this is the outline. If you want the top to be, you know, you want to have a look at the slides, I can mail all of you these slides. It's not an issue. So first let's discuss broad areas of function that our department represents. So first thing is analysis. Okay? So analysis, immediately what comes to your mind is limits, continuity, differentiability, and what else? And it's based, so far you have had courses, real analysis, or even in calculus we did some of these things, right? Differentiability, hard dimensions, and so on. So that is analysis you have seen so far, but there are many sides to it. Some of them are written over here. The major theory, integration, differential equations, complex analysis, functional analysis, Fourier analysis. Some keywords you can take away with you and Google if you wish. Okay? But if I have to give you a main feature of analysis, which is it will always deal with questions, study of functions. You want to study continuity, you want to study properties of function in the sense of epsilon delta type of analysis. But it can have different flavors, right? It can have flavor of geometry, it can have flavor of topology, and so on. So, for instance, if you go to Fourier analysis, it's very useful theory which is developed to understand solutions of PDEs. It is being used in engineering, in chemistry. One of my our colleague here, Dr. Bharadwaj Satyamurthy, he showed me his big apparatus, some 21 Tesla NMR spectroscope. And he told me how things are, first of all, some observation is recorded. Motion of an atom is recorded, but then ultimately whatever data comes you have to analyze that, and they use two-dimensional Fourier analysis to do that. Okay, Without this, many of the branches of engineering and other sciences will not be possible. Okay? So, complex analysis is another wonderful subject. It is mixture of geometry, analysis, and it is being useful. You might have seen some beautiful pictures of Mandelbrot set, Julia set, right? They are all part of complex analysis. Then, major theory integration is it's an area where you have you want to generalize the analysis that you do on your real Euclidean space. You want to go to some other abstract setting. But of course, when you do that, there is definitely an answer to why question. Why go there? Why do analysis elsewhere? Okay? Many times in physics, you require that some analytical tools be carried over to some abstract manifold or some setup where you cannot see it or imagine it in RN or three-dimensional Euclidean space. So you have to have certain tools developed for that. So major theory takes care of that. By the way, this appears also in economics, and continuously applications of those abstract ideas are being found in other sciences. Okay? So I think I have stressed it. But this, I am sort of throwing at you some few words, or I am trying to just open up the doors of various lines of thinking. Please feel free to approach any faculty in mathematics so that you can discuss detailed, you know, what you can do with, let's say, complex analysis, what you can do, what you can achieve. They will give you a better idea. Since this is a short talk, I will just try to impress upon you that there are thousands of possibilities that you can pursue during your bachelor's BSMS program. Okay. Next thing is algebra. Right? So algebra, you have had courses on, I think, linear algebra. So linear algebra, then you will go for vector spaces. There is more to it. This group theory, number theory, Galois theory, representation theory. These are some advanced algebraic theories that again appear in various areas of other sciences. Okay? So, but what is algebra? If one asks that question, my answer would be, let's say you are given a setup and you are given operations on objects in your setup. Setup meaning you would start with some collection of objects and let's say you know how to multiply them or combine them. For instance, molecules, you can concatenate molecules, carbon molecules, and get a more longer chain and so on. So this is an operation between two objects, right, which produces third object. So in such an abstract setting, the algebra will capture the overall structure of what all possible combinations are there. You want to study the space of all possible combinations, right? So you have some set of formal rules to combine objects and get a new object, okay? So that is algebra. You have abstract set and you have abstract operation where you can combine two elements. Or you can consider even generalizing that idea. You can combine several objects at a time. But you want to study what is the structure of that operation? Can you say something deeper? Okay. So that is roughly what algebra deals with. And obviously applications are tremendous. Computer science, chemistry, cryptography, all our email passwords, everything is based on these theories. Okay, they are pretty advanced stuff and very interesting stuff. You can, in computer science also, have you had course in algorithms or let's say, or you may have had seen something, right, along those lines. So, I can just probably make a remark that all that you do in algebra, especially group theory, number theory, Galois theory, representation theory, all these topics get used in other branches of science. Physics is missing that, but physics does use lot of all these advanced theories. So algebra is another branch, and next is geometry and topology, where main purpose is to study the shape of the object or possible geometry of the object. For instance, this vada that you have every morning, what possible geometry it supports? Okay. What are the all possible shapes of this vada that can happen? You can give a nice description of that. That's the aim of geometry and topology. Well, you have already had this MTH 201. I happen to be the instructor. I hope I gave you enough motivation that it is related to geometry and topology. So, where it is in branches of physics, biology, chemistry, communication networks, etc. So, there are many names that are not written over here, but almost anywhere you can find geometry and topology. In fact, I have to, if I quote Plato, he used to say that a person without the knowledge of geometry should not call himself educated. So, it is indeed true that if you want to study any kind of science, geometry will pop somewhere. Okay? So, there are courses, advanced courses in geometry and topology later on in the coursework. You can do a project. For instance, there are now a batch of students who is going to fourth year, and some of them have talked to me. I am offering some projects in geometry and topology, just to give you an idea what kind of projects we are offering in this area. If you want to talk about projects and all the possibilities that are there in the fifth year, then you please approach faculty members, have a chat with your seniors. What kind of projects they did, what was their experience, and so on. Okay, so these some of the projects that I am offering, I can share with you this information. So the coming year, one of the students is going to study objects, three-dimensional objects. What are possible three-dimensional objects? This is two-dimensional objects, right? This, suppose an ant is crawling on this shape. It will see its world two-dimensional. These two parameters are enough to describe its position to its fellow ant. Right? So then one can ask the following question: what are the all possible shapes? Can an ant discover what kind of world it is living in? Right? So intrinsically it is possible to discover. By staying on the surface of Earth, you can tell that Earth is round. By taking measurements, I don't have to fly out to into, you know, some orbit and then say that yes, it is indeed round. You can just make measurements and conclude that Earth is a round sphere. Okay. So one of the students that who will do a project with me, he is going to study something similar in dimension 3. What are all possible shapes in dimension 3? Okay. And how we can combine two such objects, produce a new one, and so on. There is a nice calculus, there is a nice way of manipulating objects even in dimension 3. Okay, so we are going to study that. There is kind of periodic table of three-dimensional objects. Let me put it this way. You can combine the basic elements and form new objects. Okay, so he is going to study that. Then there is another student who had some inclination for biology. So we are going to study topology of RNA. Okay. Now RNA is, first of all, it doesn't, if you take the traditional viewpoint, RNA or anything from biology, why should mathematics appear there? But it seems that in the reactions that RNA goes through, or whenever replication has to happen, the RNA has, the spatial shape of RNA does matter a lot. I may be wrong in saying some of the things, but correct me if I'm wrong. Because I'm just telling you what I've learned from my biology friends. Okay? Yeah, and my knowledge should be incomplete. So, but I know for the fact that how it is coiled in the three space does affect the kind of reaction that there is stereochemistry, right? So the shape of the molecule does matter, and RNA is a very long molecule. So one needs to have understanding of its secondary structure, meaning how it is coiled up and so on. All that can be captured in geometry and topology. And we can predict to a great extent what reactions are possible, what are not possible. Okay? Just the shape determines what is not possible. So one of the students is going to pursue something in that direction. And in fact, the status of that subject is such that mathematical biology is such that anything that you apply from little bit of advanced mathematics, almost certainly it is not been done before. It is widely open topic which has not been studied at all. And the reason being that mathematics community and biology community, they have been staying away from each other for a long time for no reason. So now at a place like ICER, we should talk to each other and get some work done, and in the process produce some good BSMS thesis, PhD thesis, and so on. Okay. So that's about geometry and topology. BSMS program in mathematics as major, you can still opt for minor topics or minor subjects, and that will give you an interdisciplinary flavor. Okay, you can say that you have had like major in mathematics but minor in biology, or that might help you later. Okay, all those combinations, all possible paths, you can chart out later, but I'll try to give you a flavor what you can do. Okay? So you can take courses from physics, chemistry, biology. Some courses are written over here, but this is not all possibilities. Okay? This is just to name a few. We can have a look at manual if you are interested in some other topic which does not fall exactly in mathematics major curriculum. You can still go for it. So without spending much time, I'll come to, okay, these are, since we have now two more disciplines in our institute, namely humanities and engineering, you can also take up courses from humanities and engineering. Yeah, so what can you do with when you have a BSMS degree in mathematics? Okay, the major reason why you have chosen this program is to pursue a career in science. Okay, so the major direction is to go for PhD in mathematics. Okay, if you take mathematics as major, so there are various institutes in India which offer you PhDs in mathematics, and all of them are growing at a rapid pace, and I hope by the time you graduate you will have plenty of opportunities to pursue a PhD in mathematics in various institutes, and I'm sure that there will be representations of lot of areas of mathematics. There will be faculty members throughout India will be pursuing research in that respective area. Okay, so you will have plenty of choices. But when you pursue a PhD, of course, how do you manage your finances? Okay, I think by now you have figured that out, right? The same model works. You apply for fellowships. Okay, there are plenty of fellowships, and I think now even the private companies like Infosys, they are also offering scholarships. Okay. If you want a detailed account, maybe you can talk to me later. There are PhD fellowships from corporate world also. It's possible. Or you can go abroad for but you know the root GRE, and you have to give subject GRE, TOEFL and all that. One advantage of going abroad is probably you will work with, you will see a new environment, you will see how other countries pursue sciences. You will learn, you will see the difference where we lack and where we succeed. Okay, that could be advantage of going abroad. So let's say if you don't pursue PhD in mathematics, then what you can do? If you are seeking for a job or some temporary job for a couple of years just to have an experience in industry, there are plenty of companies who hire mathematics masters. Okay, there is Cognizant Labs in Pune, Bangalore. Then just to name a few, Geometric Softwares. Then there is, or you can start up your own company if you have some good idea. You can definitely do. I know some such examples who have after their MS in computer science, couple of people got together and they founded their own company and they're doing well. Okay, but that is again an adventurous path, challenging. Very, you have to be very creative. So probably, I don't know. I mean, at this point, I have given you some idea. I mean, there are plenty of ways that you can proceed or find out or chart out a path that will be fulfilling. So I'll be happy to take up questions from you. Please feel free to share any questions.